So in a right triangle, the length of the hypotenuse c squared equals to the sum of the square of the two other sides, a squared plus b squared. This is called the Pythagorean theorem. So, yeah, that's between the Pythagorean theorem. And then there's trigonometric functions. There's if say this angle is theta, we have the sine function, sine theta, which is the ratio of the opposite side of the angle, A, over the hypotenuse, C. So sine theta equal to A over C. And we have cosine function. Cosine of this angle would be the adjacent side, B, over the hypotenuse, C. B over C is like a projection onto this side. And then tangent function. Tangent theta would be the ratio of the opposite side and with the adjacent side over B. There are three basic trigonometric functions. And then there are the inverse of them. So if you have sine of an angle equal to the ratio, corresponding ratio in the right triangle, so if you are given this ratio, you can work out the angle by using the inverse of sine, which is arcsine. You wrote written this. This will give you the angle. See. And similarly, there's arc cosine and arc tangent. These are the corresponding function and the inverse function. So when you're working with trigonometric functions, if you're calculating with your calculator, one thing you need to pay attention to is the unit for the angles. So basically there are two different units for angle. There's degree and there's radian. The relationship between them, the covariance between them is for degree, these are just proportional. For a right angle, in degree it would be 90 degrees. In radian it's pi over 2. A flat angle is 180 degrees and pi in radian. A full circle is 360 degrees and will be 2 pi in radian. So you can see that the conversion is degree divided by 100 times pi give you the radian. Identities. You probably have noticed here, sine is A over C, cosine is B over C, then tangent is A over B. So if we divide sine theta with cosine theta, then the C just cancel out, give you A over B, which is tangent theta. So this is the first identity. Tangent theta is sine theta over cosine theta. Next, if you combine the sine and the cosine with the Pythagorean theorem, Pythagorean theorem states that a squared plus b squared equal to c squared. So here is a over c, here is b over c. If we square sine theta and square cosine theta, adding them together, that's sine theta squared plus cosine theta squared, then it will give us, that's a squared over c squared plus b squared over c squared. And the numerator is a squared plus b squared, which according to Pythagorean theorem is just c squared. It's the same as the denominator. So that just gives us 1. So this is the second identity. Sine theta squared plus cosine theta squared gives you 1. Okay, now these are very simple. Let's have a very simple exercise. We have a right triangle. Angle BCA here is a right angle of 90 degrees. This side BC, the length is 6. The hypotenuse is AB, length is 10. So what's the length of the other side AC? Second part, what's the angle BAC and ABC? Okay, this should be pretty straightforward. For the first one, you just use Pythagorean theorem. AC squared plus BC squared give you the square of the hypotenuse. So that's AC squared is just 10 squared minus 6 squared. So AC is 100 minus 36, which is 8. So now we have AC equal to 8. Now the second one is asking for angles. You're only given the length of the side. You don't have to know any angle except this is 90 degrees. So you need to use the inverse function of this of the trigonometric function, the arcus functions. So for example, BAC, this angle. This one, you can, since you already know the length of every side, so you can either, for example, you can use arc sine. If you're using arc sine, then it will be BC over AB, 6 over 10. That gives you 36.9, or about 36.9 degrees, I think. Or you can use arc cosine. If you use our cosine, it would be the adjacent side over the hypotenuse, 8 over 10, which gives you the same result. Or use our tangent, which would be 6 over 8, which is the same thing. After you have angle BAC, to solve for angle ABC, you can either use the same thing, arc sine, arc cosine, or arc tangent here, or you can use 90 degrees minus our angle BAC. Because this is the right triangle, these two angles adding up together should give you 90 degrees. This would be about 53.1 degrees. All right. That's trigonometry. trigonometry itself is not hard, not difficult at all, but when you combine it with others, it may get complicated. For example, moving on to the next, we talk about vectors. So in physics, you're dealing with a lot of variables, and there are different kinds of variables. Most of them you will come across with are either scalar or vector. So what's the difference? For a scalar, a scalar is just a variable you can just use a number to describe it. Say, for example, a distance would be a scalar. From here to there is 5 meters, and 5 meters is just 5 meters. Say, time, length, these are just scalars. You can just use one number. The difference of vector is it not only has a number, which we call magnitude, it also has direction. Direction of a vector is important, is not negligible. For example, force is a vector. If say you have a force, a 5 newton force, 5 newton would be the magnitude of the force. But if you only say 5 newton, that's not complete. You have to also give the information of its direction, where the force is pointing at. Because for a force, like pointing upwards or pointing downwards would have very different effects on an object. And for example, velocity is also a vector. Velocity, displacement. Displacement basically means how far it moved, but not only you have to say how far it moved, you have to also say towards which direction. So basically the magnitude of displacement would be distance. So those are the vectors. The reason the direction really matters in vector is because for example, we are adding two variables together. If they are just scalars, say you have a equal to 2, b equal to 2, and then we all know a plus b is 4. That's as easy as that. But for a vector, for vectors, it's not simple as that. Say you have a 2 newton force and another 2 newton force. They don't, when they add up together, they don't necessarily give you a 4 newton force. If, say, they are opposite from each other. Now we all know that when adding up together, they just cancel each other out, give you a zero. So direction really matters for vectors, especially when you are adding vectors together. So how do you add vectors? How do you even, like say, how do you even describe a vector, represent it? Now, for at least this semester, all the vectors you will be dealing with are all constrained within a plane, which means it's a two-dimensional case, which means I can draw it on the board. Okay. You don't have to worry about three-dimensional case. So for a two-dimensional case, a vector can be represented in x and y components. Now, first, usually when we draw a vector, we want to represent it graphically, we draw an arrow. With an arrow, the length represents the magnitude of the vector. How long the length, the larger the magnitude is, the longer the length would be. Then where the arrow is pointing at gives you the direction. So that's how we draw a vector. So this is vector A. Usually when we write the letter for a vector, we add a small arrow on the head, okay, just to differentiate it from a scale. Now, if you usually when the letter is printed, it's not like this, but it's in bold font. So that's vector. So to represent it, we can put it in coordinates. If I draw coordinates here, x and y axis and the origin. Notice that I'm putting the beginning of the end of the tail of the arrow at the origin. Now, the vector doesn't necessarily have to start from the origin. It can be put anywhere in the coordinate. But this way is most convenient. Usually we prefer it this way. And this will also allow us to see the components. So what are the components? The components are the projections of the vector onto the axis. For example, the x component would be, you just project it onto x axis. Then this is its x component, ax. And similarly, if we project it to y axis, this would be the y component, ay. Now, both components can be positive or negative. In this case, they are both positive because it's in the first quadrant. So now to write this vector A down, you can write it this way. A equal to AX X hat plus AY Y hat. Now what are these AX hat and Y hat? These are called bases. What about bases? Now x is just a unit vector pointing at x direction. So a unit vector means the magnitude, the length of this vector is 1. So basically it means x is just 1, 0. And y is a unit vector pointing at y direction, so that means it's 0, 1. Vector. Now, how do you add two vectors together, two or more? We can begin from, start from two. So when you add two vectors together, say I have a vector A here, I have another vector similarly, let's say B, which is BX and BY. If I add them together, you're adding two vectors together, you just add the components together to be the resultant component. That means you add the x component of A with the x component of B to be the x component of the resultant vector. So AX plus BX is the x component of A, of A plus B. And the y component would be, you're adding the y component together, ay plus by. This is how you add the two vectors together. Now this is adding two. If you add three or more, basically it's the same thing. Say if you have a c here, then you just add cx here, add cy here. You just keep adding the corresponding components to be the resulting components. Now that's adding. What about subtracting? So what's A minus B? Well, subtracting is essentially the same as adding, because A minus B is A plus negative B. And if this is B, then negative B is just negative bx, negative by. So that means this would be ax minus bx to be the x component, by minus by to be the y component. So that's how you're adding, subtracting vectors. Now, this is when you are given, the components of vectors and adding them, subtracting them together. What about you're given graph, some arrows as vectors? How do you find out? Yes.
Just in addition to like the x, what's the name of it? The x and the y, we'll think of it. Remember that?
This.
Yeah.
Basis.
Basis.
Yes.
Aren't I and j also used?
I and g.
Like I and like j.
Oh, it's the same thing.
Same thing? Huh?
Yeah, it's just different notation. Same thing. It's the same thing. Yeah, some use I, J instead of X, Y. Just the same thing. Okay. All right. If you're given some arrows, how do you find the resultant vectors graphically? Say, for example, if I draw two vectors, A, B. This is all I have. How do I find A plus B in the graph? If I'm given, say, rulers, protractor, compass, how do I find A plus B? Now, this requires something called parallelogram law. So basically, parallelogram law says A plus B, if you want to find A plus B, you need to find the parallelogram that formed by the vector A and B. So which means you need to find this parallelogram. So a parallelogram is this shape where the opposite side is parallel with each other and have the same lens. So these two sides have the same lens and is parallel, and these two same lens parallel. So you find this parallelogram first, then A plus B would just be the diagonal line here. That's A plus. So if say this is O, now we can see that since this side and this side is parallel and same lens, so that means this lens here is essentially the same as vector A. So basically, what the parallelogram law did is just you move vector A to the tip of vector B, then the resultant vector is just from the start, the beginning of vector B, to the end of vector A, to the end of the next one. Or you can look at it the other way. You are moving B to here, then you start from here to here. And this is actually consistent with what we have here, adding the components. This can be demonstrated this way. Let's add the coordinates here. Let's say this is x coordinate, x axis, and we have y axis. And you can see the x component of the A plus B is just the x component of A plus the x component of B, this part, because this is essentially the same as B. This would be dx plus ax. The y component is, in this case, since the x component, the x axis is overlapping vector A, the y component of vector A is zero, so it's just the y component of vector B. Now that's adding. What about, I want to find A subtracting B, given only two arrows. Then again, adding is the same as, subtracting is the same as adding. So we need to find negative B. Then negative B, In the graph, the negative of a vector would be the vector with same magnitude but opposite direction. So that means if this is vector B, negative vector B would be here, the same length but 180 degrees apart, negative B. Now you have a negative b, you add a and negative b together, will give you a minus b.
So what's your line? Do you just find it parallelogram, or where would you like draw it to?
But in this case, it will be here, here. So this will be where a minus b be. This is not the best handling. I hope you get this picture. And one more thing. When you are given the components of a vector, say ax, ay, how do you calculate the magnitude of it? Now, a magnitude of a vector is usually written down as this. It's the same as the absolute value sign to vertical lines around it. This means the magnitude of this vector. So if say you know ax and ay, how do you calculate the magnitude? Now here, dealing with these letters or numbers, you might have not a clue. So we should draw it. So if you have, say, a, now what you know is ax and ay, what you want to solve for is this, the magnitude. Remember, length represents the magnitude. So how do you solve for it? Now I can see a right triangle. This one or this one. Essentially the same. Let's use this one. In this right triangle, this side is ax, this side is ay. So this would be the hypotenuse. So that means the magnitude of a vector is just the square root of the sum of the square of the components. And also, when you have the graph here, not only can you calculate the magnitude, you can also use arcsine, arccosine, arctangent, the arcus functions, to calculate the angles here and here, the angles between the vector and the axis. Just use arcsine or arccosine. Actually arctangent if you only know the component. All right, I think that's it. Now let's try some exercises. First, some easy ones. Right, I have two vectors, vector A, is 3 minus 6. B is 2 plus 5. Okay. Now, what is A plus B? What is A minus B? The magnitude of A minus B. If you think part 1, part 2 is too easy for you, here's part 3 for a little challenge. What's the angle between A and B? view left. I think you can use, you can only use the same you learned today to solve the number theory. But you can also use, that's called cosine law. From the feedback I get from last session, 1 and 2 is easy. So if you have no clue on number 3, I suggest you do a little sketch and see if you can have an insight. And after you finish, or you don't think you can solve it, you can have a little discussion with people around you. These are the answers for number 1 and number 2. I hope these should be easy for you. A plus B, you just add the components, this gives you 5, this gives you -1, easy. A minus B, first you work out the vector, that will be negative X, negative 11Y, positive X, negative 11Y. Then you calculate the magnitude, which would be 1 squared plus 11 squared, take the square root, which is square root 122. The third one, you need to make a sketch. Now, someone has already mentioned, this can be solved directly by if you know inner product or cosine law, but it's not impossible to solve using what I covered today only. Okay, so basically, if you draw your two vectors in two coordinates, A is 3, negative 6, that's in the fourth quadrant, here's A. B both components are positive in the first quadrant. So you need to find this angle here. You don't, anything you learn, you don't know how to solve it directly, but you can break it apart into two angles. This one and this one. Okay, so let's call this alpha, this is beta. So this angle theta equals to alpha plus beta. Let's solve them respectively. So how to solve this? Well, we can make it a right triangle. Then this side is the y component of b. This side is the x component of b. So that means alpha is the arctangent by over bx. Now similarly, we have numbers, so I can fit these in. That would be this is b, that's 5 over 2. Okay. Similarly, you can solve for beta. So basically, this is 6 and this is 3. So beta equal to arc tangent 6 over 3. Now, here it's not positive 6, it's negative 6, but here you don't have to write the negative sign because when using this, you're using the length of the side, which should be an absolute value. Okay. Now then, after you calculate these two, you just add them together. If you have calculated, you can check your answer. It should be 131.6, around that value. I hope you understand this, because I want to move on to the next difficult level.
I have a quick question.
Yes.
Where did you get the 5 from in the arcane?
So here, when you calculate the alpha, tangent is this side over this side, and this is the same thing as this, which is you're just projecting b onto y-axis, which is the y component of b, and that's given in the here I just erased, but it's 2x plus 5y, so that's where the 5 comes from. So these lengths are the components. Moving on to the next exercise. Right. So I hope you are comfortable to work with letters, because usually you can calculate with numbers fine, but with letters it's just the same thing. So here's the next question. I have a vector A with a magnitude of, let's say, I'm going to use letter A, and a vector B, magnitude of B. And the angle in between them, so this pointy bracket means the angle in between them is, say, theta. So what is the magnitude of A plus B? If you're not comfortable working with letters, I can just fill in numbers for you. Say this is 6.5, say this is 3, say this is 30 degrees. You can use whichever you like. Again, I think on first sight, you just staring at this will give you nothing. Make a sketch, I mean, it will help you a great deal more. And remember, when you are doing it graphically, how do you find A plus B? So you just draw A, draw B, then draw A plus B, and then try to solve A. This one's a little bit hard. if you can solve this problem, I'd say you really know well about trigonometry, at least this is mathematics, not physics. So by the way, if you don't know how to solve this, it's fine. For the physics class, all you need to know how to do is the first exercise level. That one, you have to know how to do it. This is a bit advanced level, but it's definitely solvable with what I covered today. And it's a bit fun to like have a try on it. Say, this one, A and B, let's draw a sketch. I'm just drawing randomly vector A, vector B. Now, if I want to find the magnitude of A plus B, let's find A plus B first. That's just law of parallelogram. You draw a parallelogram, the diagonal line is A plus B. Now I want the magnitude of it. So to calculate the magnitude, how do we do it? We need to find the x component and y component, and take the square root, square them, plus them, and then take the square root. But here I don't have the I don't have x-axis, y or a y-axis. How do I know the x and y components? So the coordinates are a reference. So if you don't have coordinates, you can create them. And how do you choose coordinates? Since it's just a reference, you can choose wherever you like, however you want. Since we can choose however we like, we just choose as convenient as possible in our favor. So we can just go ahead and make x-axis overlap with A. So that means A would be parallel with our x-axis. Now y-axis is just perpendicular to it. Now this is how I choose the coordinate. You can choose differently. Say you choose x-axis to be along with B, or you choose x-axis to be along with A plus B. It's both fine. You can always solve the problem. The result will be the same. Let's see how we get it in this way. This way, A would be, the x component would be just its magnitude, since it's lying on x-axis. So it's just A, x. B would be, this angle here is given theta between them. The x component would be just cos, which is this lens. Now this lens is B cosine theta, right? The magnitude of B cosine theta. Because cosine theta is the adjacent lens, which is Bx, divided by the hypotenuse, which is the magnitude of B. So that means Bx is B, the magnitude of B cosine theta. And similarly, you have the y component of B, B sine theta. Now add them together, A plus B would be A. You add, this is X component, this is Y component. You add the components together. Right. Now you have A plus B to solve for its magnitude, just to use the components squared.